Champ, I want to ask you. I've read this about you before, but I want to. You have a son. I met him. And how would you feel if he wanted to become a boxer? Assuming that he had your ability and your kind of talent. How would you feel then?
It's a different question.
That's right.
No, I still wouldn't. I would take him in, like, he's got a tutor now. He's gonna speak three languages. It's four languages.
What languages?
He's going to speak English, Arabic, French, and Spanish. All my children. And when you're young, you can catch on real quick.
Absolutely.
Oh, you got, that's when you have the ear for it. That's
and
right.
We're going to, like, I got teachers. I put the money up already, and they're going to, private teachers. Nowadays, when the kids in the classroom, we got 35 children. He can't really be taught.
There's no one-to-one relationship.
I'm going to get a top-notch teacher and just let him or her teach them four. And all the monies that I'm making now, I'm going to be sure that they won't be nothing like me. If I couldn't box, I don't know probably where I would be. So I know the value of it.
You're a beautiful man. Besides your fighting, you got a soul and a heart and a mind that is incredible. And if your sons had that, they would be a lot of people.
I just want him to study.
But Muhammad, look what it's done for you. You're saying you wouldn't want him to be. If he had your ability,
I've been so lucky.
But if he had
he might have the ability, but not that luck.
Yeah, but who would know it quicker than you that he had that ability? You could see it immediately.
It's just bad business. I want to be a lawyer or something, a doctor, not a boxer.
But what's your number one preference, lawyer? Want him to study law?
Doctor.
You want him to be doctor? What if he doesn't want to be? Then what?
Well, you know, I can't handle it. After he's my age, I'll be so old and tired, I really won't care. But right now, I'm going to handle him from up until he's 18 years old. I'll have a little...
How do you handle him? Are you strict? Do you ever give him a pat?
Never.
You do it all with words?
And just look at him, he'll cry. It's a certain way you can look at them. See, you can't whip
children.
You can't whip children if I do wrong, because, you see, I see myself. I did the same thing. We all still do wrong.
Were you spanked as a kid?
Yeah. My father, boy, he put your head in his legs and go get green switches. Man. But there was more punishing than worrying. My mother, after I knew I did something wrong, it was more waiting to be whipped than worse than whipping his
ass. That's the worst. My father used to come home on Saturday like 4. My mother would say, he didn't. He'd say, I'll see you in the garage at 7. Now you got 3 hours. 3 hours. You keep saying, hi, Dad. Look at your son. He's studying. Oh, you know you're going to get it. Joe Frazier spanks his kids. He told me so. Joe Frazier spanks his kids.
Joe's lucky. He's got big children. He started young. He's got children with his daughters as tall as him.
He's got a son bigger than him.
Yeah, man.
Is he big?
I don't know why he stayed in shape so long. He's lucky. I give up all my wealth, all my title. I give up every quarter, and if all my children could be the size of his, say 14 or 15 or 16, while I'm at this age enjoying them, I'd give up everything I got and ever had if they could be that way now.
You want more kids, Ken? You want more kids?
Yeah.
How many? You have 4 now, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
Anything to tell us? No more on
none your business.
I have a feeling the number's going to go up shortly. I want to bring out a man whom you all know. We're going to show you his new book here in just a moment. He devoted the whole book entirely to your recent fight with George Foreman when you regained the championship. It's called The Fight, and it was written by one of the finest writers I know, and I'd like to introduce him to you now. Here's Pulitzer Prize-winning author Norman Mailer. I know that you love boxing. You're an avid fight fan. Did you hear him say he'd give up every quarter just to have children the age of Joe Frazier's children? Would you give up everything to be where he is, be the champ?
Would I give up everything to be the champ? Oh, no, I'm happy I'm a rider. You know, I wouldn't want to be a fighter as opposed to being a rider, but it's one of the things I would really maybe would like to be, except it's easy to say. When you're a fighter, you take a lot of punishment. I'm not taking that into account.
He doesn't take a lot of punishment.
Well,
he's not marked up at all.
I take punishment, but I just don't show it. I take a lot. My jaw's been broke, man. And I take a lot of punishment. I be hit a lot, but I have ways of showing that I'm not. I act like I'm not, but I'm in training. I take punishment every day.
But you know something that nobody, not many people know? Only the people who follow fighting, he's got a tremendous jaw, this guy. He really has.
No, I think by now people in boxing recognize that.
I'm talking about the average public.
Ali, you know, it's known in boxing, Ali takes a tremendous punch.
What do you mean by tremendous jaw?
No, you take a terrific punch. You've been hit so flush and just come right back, and the next thing you know, you've won the fight. I've seen that happen. Guy gets in, a lucky punch in your case. They don't hit you that often. Why did you decide to devote a whole book to a single sporting event?
I didn't. It grew. I was doing 20,000 words for Playboy, and then after I'd written about, which is about, in an average book, 20,000 words would be about 50 pages. And after I'd written maybe 10,000 words, I said, well, here we go again. This isn't going to be a magazine article. It's going to be a book. There was just so much happening in Africa, and the fight, I thought, was a great fight, one of the two or three greatest fights I ever saw, and I'd always wanted to do a book about boxing, and it all fit the place, and I thought, I thought Ali really fought an incredible fight. I think it's maybe the greatest single fight ever fought by one man. I wouldn't call it the greatest fight I ever saw, because finally, while he had much trouble with Foreman now and again, he finally dominated him so much that it was a one-man fight.
That wasn't the greatest fight you ever saw.
Well, the greatest one I ever saw was the Ollie Fraser.
The first Ollie Fraser fight.
This was me.
What segment of the population, Norman, was your present book written for, would you say?
You know, funny way, I think I wrote it for women rather than for men.
I can't conceive of a woman seeing that title and picking that book up and saying, this I've got to read.
Leave it to me. You know, I write a book for women and then I call it The Fight. You know, can you do anything dumber than that? I've noticed that whenever I take a woman to a prize fight, she always seems to understand it better than a man does. When men see prize fights, their own ego's involved. They're always saying to themselves, am I tough enough to get in the ring? What would I do if I hit one of these guys in a dark alley? They're always thinking negatively. A woman goes, she sees the two attractive men there usually.
Two attractive men.
Men. We're talking about your fight. We're talking about just two young fighters.
Oh, yeah.
So they look at it, and then they see very quickly that what's going on is really a conversation between the two men. Just they're using their bodies and their... But, you know, people can punish each other in conversation.
Oh, yes.
You know, people have said things to other people, and this person who hears it walks away, and then they faint. So there is such a thing as a knockout in dialogue, and people do always punish each other all the time. So women understand that. They understand it very well.
Well, why do you think the book will appeal to women as opposed to men?
I just noticed that. I've noticed that if anything, women like it better than men. That's
interesting. You were a boxer one time, and what was your record?
0-0. I started boxing late. I started boxing when I was about 30. And my second marriage was to a young lady whose father had been a professional fighter, a man named Al Morales. And whenever he came to visit, he'd get restless after a while. He'd say, come on, let's put on the gloves. So I learned how the hard way, because he was a tough Indian. And he was 50 years old at the time, and I was 30, but he was in marvelous shape. And so I used to have to work and sweat, because after a while he'd get excited and he'd start hitting hard. And then once I knocked him down, and he got up mad, and I knocked him down again. I said, well, I've arrived. I really can box. And I used to run around telling people for a few days, that poor old man, you know, it's a short story. It's the end of his career. So next time he came out, we boxed, and he knocked me down twice. After that, we both used to breathe a little heavy when we put on the gloves. I boxed with other people. Oddly enough, until pretty recently, I only boxed really with very good fighters. I boxed with Roger Donahue for a while, and I boxed once with Tiger Jones, and then I spent a whole summer boxing with Jose Torres.
Do you ever box with him?
No.
I want to tell you something. I've gotten in the ring as a gag a couple of times with this man, and my own wife said, it's a good thing you were bending over. The punches he was throwing, it was just faking it. So if you'd ever lifted your head up, that would have been the end of you. It's an awesome sight to stand in front of, not only because he's Muhammad Ali, because he's big, and he looks at you a certain way, you know. He does a lot, beautiful psych job, doesn't he?
Oh, yeah, sure. But, you know, actually, I never got hurt boxing with good fighters, because...
I did.
Well, I never did. Boxed with Jose Torres, I never learned anything about offense, because anytime I hit him, it was, you know, with his greeting card. But I learned a little about defense, because when I'd make mistakes, he'd tap me. And if I kept making the same mistake, he'd tap me a little harder until finally I developed a few natural reflexes on defense. Offense, I boxed him a whole summer. And once in the whole summer, I hit him a right hand, landed a right hand. He ran out of the ring. He was so happy. He said, he hit me with the right hand. He hit me with the right hand.
We're going to keep Norman Mailer and everyone. We'll be right back. Right. You first start to study Muhammad's preparation for the four-man fight.
I think I really started studying it back in about 1964, 65 in Boston when, I forget the exact year, but it was when you were getting ready for the second fight with Liston from 65. And Ollie used to train in a gym then in Boston for a period. And he used to have a sparring partner named Shotgun Sheldon. He used to let Shotgun Sheldon pound away on his body on the ropes. And I noticed that I figured then that what you were doing, the way I understood it then, was that you were setting up situations where, let's say in the 12th round of, well, was a possible, you know, fantasy in the 12th round of a fight with Liston, if it went a long distance, and you were arm weary and, you know, and were just having to take his beating on the ropes, you wanted to toughen yourself for that kind of thing. And Ollie used to take these punches. Shotgun Sheldon would hit him 50 or 100 punches, and Ollie would just, you know, move his stomach, would take the punches, and test how his muscles could take these punches.
That's true, Muhammad.
Well, yes, and like, you notice an astronaut or somebody before he goes in space, they do everything on the ground just like it would happen in space. You know, he'll get in a room with no gravity and he'll try to maneuver with a wrench and where his whole body will turn and in case something happens. And so this is where I train from boxing. I look bad in gymnasium. People watch me train. He's not in shape. He's going to lose the fight. I don't go and train him to beat my partners up. I try my left jab. I lay on the rope in case I should get hurt and I'm blind for a second and I have to stay in the corner. I just go through all of that. And this is what I was doing. And it did happen. I did. No, it was the first day when I couldn't see. So wrong. Oh,
wasn't that something that rosin or something that was on the glove that got in your eye?
Yes. I later found out what that was. A fellow came to my gymnasium. I won't say his name, who he was. But he came to my gymnasium 1-4-4-4. He said, I have something you can put on your gloves if you get in trouble. And the perspiration and the heat and everything, he knows it won't hurt you. But if you see for a round, then you can get it. And that same fellow I found out knew Liston.
Oh, yeah.
The time I go Liston, that's what happened to me.
Did you train harder? Do you feel, Norman, that he trained harder for the former fight than any other fight?
I trained longer, not harder. Well, I trained a long time. We got over that, the former got cut, and the fight was set back an extra
a month. Yeah.
And I was already bored and ready to go. We had to set down 4 more weeks and wait. And I just took advantage of it and rest and trained. So
In cases like that, doesn't a fighter sometimes lose that edge that he's prepared for?
Yeah, I think that's the, you know, the trick is precisely to keep enough of the edge so that, you know, if you overtrain, you just get bored. Boredom is the key problem in training because it's practically like living in prison. I mean, a man has no fun.
Yeah. It's an event and then it's over. There is a climax and then it's over.
Yeah.
It must be a terrible letdown after a fight and that. After building up to that peak, even though you win, isn't there a terrible mental letdown, kind of when the adrenaline stops flowing?
Well, this is why I don't really pay no attention to the... I heard someone once say, life is very deceiving. Life is a big liar. Its fame and its glory are very short-lived. And we think about Nixon yesterday, we think about Kennedy, we think about Nat King Cole, we think about Louis Armstrong, we think about once Rome flourished with flowers and gardens, it's just ruins now. Egypt, Cleopatra, Nefertiti, all of that's over. And the odds are 50 years from today, all of us here are going to be dead, and there's going to be somebody else on the shore in the sea. And it's all short-lived, you know. So I think about that. This is where I'm going to build my life on championship things which allow for change and destruction. See, most people build their life on outer life, and outer life is based on things which allow for change. Politics change, a new president comes, and many people lose their jobs. Well, I try to build my life on inner life, you know, things that are not liable for change and destruction. And so the title and the championship is just a vehicle I use to get over certain parts and messages I want to use. But you can take it all tomorrow. You can take my title. You can take all everything I've accumulated, and I'll still be happy because I don't base my life on that.
What if Frazier takes it? Then you won't be.
Wait, you can't do it.
He can't do it.
Too slow.
We'll be right back. Muhammad, since Norman used to do some fighting, and since this is what they call the heavy bag, why don't you show Dom and me, and we're very interested in what this is for.
This is, I can't really go through,
Well, what's this for?
It's just a building power, you know. Like a man like myself, I don't take advantage of my sparring partners. I don't really let go. I use them for speed and timing and accuracy and precision. And aim at the target, hit it, get away. But, I mean, landing real power, this is what you hit me. You want to build up your power, toughen up your hands.
And is that the way you do it properly? You don't put shoulder or body behind it?
Oh, well, I'm really in the gym. I really work with it, you know, but this is a cheap bag.
This is
Everlast makes the best.
Yeah,
this is one of the cheaper bags.
All right.
I have.
What's in there? Small people? What?
Some of his opponents.
No, no. This is some type of sawdust, probably some type of...
Why did they get the nickname the sand? Why did they call it the sandbag?
I mean, years ago they used to put sand in them.
But they don't anymore. You could hurt your hands.
You could hurt yourself with that.
Oh.
Does somebody usually hold it when you're working?
No, not me. I like my bag to swing around like.
Well, show us that.
Well, if you hit it, and it just moves us all. See?
And you work around it. You dance around it.
Yeah, if you have any, so I'll show you.
I hurt my wrist.
So. That's the way you do it. In other words, you build up power. You let it go.
Right. Just.
Norman, you try it. You want Tom to hold it?
Oh! I have to warn you that I'm Catholic. Hey, that's terrific.
Okay.
How about that?
What about you, Mike?
That?
Look, you made a little dent in me. That's terrific.
That's a devastating punch, isn't it, the uppercut?
If
you use a lot of
those. If you can land like a man like Joe Frazier, he's
about my height.
He's always crouching like that.
Okay.
He comes over here and comes around.
I see. He bleeds a lot.
You tap him just right. It can be dangerous.
Do you still have the quickness that you used to have?
Yes, I'm showing you something here now.
Okay.
Give me a mic.
You want me to hold it?
Take these off.
Okay.
Yes, this is where I test my speed now. A lot of people see this. You know, second son in this fighter hit him with the right hand, was so fast that people couldn't see it. They wanted the money back. They couldn't see the Sports Illustrated clock to punch at 4/100 a second. That's the eye blink. So I mean, the people blinked at that moment. They missed it.
Yeah.
Now, I can hit you six times. I can hit you six times before you count two.
Six times before I count?
I can hit you six times before you count two.
Oh, come on. I can go... Well, I'll try it.
Well, I say go, count two, like one, two, fast as you can.
Right.
Let's test it.
Go. Right. One, two.
Okay. Now I'm going to hit you six times before you count two. Watch careful. Wait, when I say go, you count two.
Right. Go. One, two.
You want to pull it again?
Mind you, once again, the book is called The Fight by one of our guests, Norman Mailer. And, of course, the champion was here to visit with us, and we're always happy for that. Thank you both very much for being here.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.